When we think about hackers, we first think about what was happening in the early times of the internet, so before the mid-90s. There was people having fun and trying new things, and the best representation, even if not the best movie, is the movie from 1995, maybe, Hackers, with a young Angelina Jolie as well.
Risk architecture is going to change everything.
Yeah, risk is good.
Because in this movie you can see also them rollerblading, going around with their computers.
That is one of my favorite films.
But now it's completely different. That's because since the WWW has been invented, we had a complete revolution where everything changed and where everything has been started being stored and information being processed and so on and so forth on the networks. Now also the banks are online. Well, not only now, it's in the last decades, let's say. But that means, again, that we have a lot of important information, a lot of money stored through online storages, servers, and networks that could be attacked. It's not only for fun, but now hackers have a different motivation, that is money. Hackers can try to, for instance, infect a computer in order to steal information, or change the advertisements in order to put your own. That would be a loss of money for other advertisers that wouldn't visualize their advertisements, and so on and so forth. So maybe not even the victim is the infected computer, but that is the medium used to attack another computer. The idea today is to go through some of these kind of infections just to show what is the motivation, why there is money involved, and what is important about that. The first infection I want to go through is information stealing malware. The two probably most famous ones are Zeus and Torpic. But in general, what does the information stealer malware do? The attack is when a computer is infected, they intercept all the possible forms. So this means they are going to try to take all the single forms you submit on the internet, a login credential, for instance, a bank credential, and they will try to steal it. What happens is we have our computer where we write the things, and our computer is infected. Now, when we log into a website, for instance, the bank, to log there, we have to send the information that are our credentials. So login, that is user and password. This is a form, but because our computer is infected, the malware is going to intercept this form, and so the form will go to the bank, but it will be also stored by the malware. At a certain point, usually as soon as possible in the moment it intercepts the forms, the malware tries to contact another machine that is usually called command and control server. When it intercepts the form, it sends it to the command and control in order to make the information available for the criminal. When this happens, the criminal is able to reuse this information to log into your bank details, for instance, or to take your Facebook credentials and log into Facebook. Now, is this valuable? Yes, it is. While maybe mail or Facebook credentials could be a few dollars, if we steal, for instance, bank details or credit card details, this could be some hundreds of dollars. And obviously, like Zeus or Torpic, we're stealing much more than a few of them. As an example, the Torpic botnet that I mentioned at the beginning, it has been able to infect over 100,000 computers per day. It was using another botnet, Mabroot, for the first infection, and then it was managing everything from the command and control servers. A problem with the first botnets before Torpic was that they were having just one command and control server, or maybe more than one, but they were hard-coded so that one infected machine was communicating only to one command and control server. In the moment you were taking down the command and control server, the infected machine was not able to act anymore. The Torpic botnet was the first one, or one of the first at least, introducing the domain generation algorithms in order to find the domain where they would have found the command and control server in a dynamical way during the infection. But what has been done by researchers in 2009 was to reverse engineer the code of the Torpic botnet in order to find out the algorithm that was generating the domain names. Because this was the first one, it was pretty easy to find out how to identify the domains before they were looked for by the different clients, the different bots. And in the moment they were about to be active, those domains would have been taken by the researchers in order to avoid that the command and control server would have been active. And by doing this, they were able to avoid that the infected machines were active because they weren't receiving any instruction and they weren't able to send anything out because the command and control servers weren't at the domains they were looking for. This was the first time they've been able to do something like that. But after some days, then for the new infections, there was a new version of Torpig that was not so easy to detect the domain generation algorithm. And from there, it has always been a kind of arms race between researchers and defenders and cybercriminals in order to find out which algorithm or other kind of situations were able to generate the domains and being able to prevent these kind of issues if you were a defender. A domain generation algorithm has to have as output a string. That is the domain itself. They have to kind of randomize the generation of the string and at the same time control this randomic generation through putting some parameters that would block to a certain state in order to know what it is about to be created. In this way, what is about to be created by the bot will be the domain that they know they can buy and they can own in order to have the command and control server active where the bot is looking for it.
How did that differ? Because surely then once it's gone to that command and control server, if you can see what it's communicating with, presumably you can stop it. Or is there a way of making it move on to another command and control server?
So command and control servers are usually active for about a day, maybe two. So when we are even able to identify one of them, we could put it down, but most of the times there is a new one going up after a day. And also now the most advanced botnets are able to redirect when you don't have the command and control server you were communicating for to a new one. So in this way, even if we put down one of the command and controls, the bot would be able to get the new command and control to communicate with. We may have a certain quantity of infected machines that are communicating to a command and control. And the same is happening with other infected machines and so on and so forth for other thousands and thousands of times. Now, if we do put down this command and control, apart from the fact that there may be a new domain generated soon and so another command and control being, well, the same command and control being able to take another domain and being active, also what can happen is that these bots that have been infected but cannot communicate here, they are going to try to communicate here or maybe to another CNC that is here with other ones in order to redistribute the load. By having different command and control servers, we have different little networks of infected machines that can be used in different ways. Another kind of malware family that is on the edge now is ransomware. As we have heard, there has been the WannaCry attack, for instance, recently, and there is already a Computerphile video on WannaCry. And we know that ransomware, what they do is to lock the computer and to encrypt the data. Now, first, before the ransomware that is already advanced, there has been screen lockers. They were working more or less in the same way, but they weren't encrypting the data. That means that your data wasn't affected, but they were just blocking yourself on that screen. So if like technicians were able to get out of that screen, you wouldn't have had to pay the ransom. And what happens instead with ransomware is that what they have is they lock the screen and they start encrypting your data. In this way, while maybe you are looking at the screen and you don't know what to do, your computer gets encrypted and encrypted and encrypted. Now, there is an interesting fact on psychology, because what they tell you is, give me the money. There are also quite nice tutorials that are linked about that and how to pay in bitcoins, for instance. Give me the money and I will give you the key to decrypt and the guide on how to decrypt with that key. And that's good, if only you are sure that this is going to happen and you are sure that this is not going to happen again with another infection. Because what you don't really know is if maybe you are able to decrypt, but the malware may still be there and may be activated further on, so you will have to pay again the ransom, for instance. That's obviously more money, but also the problem is, what if I don't give you the right key? I may ask you again for money for having another key, but then you may decide not to pay anymore. And if I do it all the time, people may not want to pay me anymore, so my whole economy would crash. So the idea is I have to give you the key in order to decrypt, because otherwise you're gonna stop paying me. That is what's suggested by the law enforcement, for instance. And in this way, I may want to leave the malware there in some stealthy way in order to be able to reuse it if I want. This could be particularly good for criminals, but that's why what law enforcement say is have a backup. And to avoid problems with the backups, now ransomware are also checking for local backups. So if you do a backup of your data on your local machine, this would be identified from the most new malware samples, and the ransomware would delete the local machine, the local copy, and you wouldn't have the backup. So what happens there is that the backup has to be more on an external hard drive or on the net, but if that is connected in the moment of the infection, that's again a problem, because ransomware tried to spread also over the network. Apart from the WannaCry example where there was a worm involved that is another family of malware, in general, ransomware look for all the devices that are connected to the computer that is infected. And if there is any device with a storage that is connected, for instance, shared documents in an office, they would encrypt also those shared documents. And that's obviously a problem, because if you have your external hard disk where you have the backups that is connected at the moment when the infection is there, the ransomware will try to encrypt also that part. That's also why when you see a ransomware infection and you know you have the backup, what they suggest you is to close as soon as possible the computer by just taking out the plug in order to avoid the ransomware to continue encrypting. Because the encryption part takes time. It's not an immediate process, and they need to let you stay in, maybe trying to understand how the payment is and so on and so forth. But if you just plug off, then you can do the backup, and obviously you may lose the most recent data, but you would avoid paying a lot of money.
I think it makes sense to just pull the plug. What would happen then, I suppose, is not turn the computer on, but take the hard disk out, I suppose, and yes. Get someone to deal with it.
Because that's again against the economy itself of the malware, because if you immediately pull it off and you do the backup over the encrypted data, then the malware can't do anything because it would be taken out as you wipe the hard disk from how it is and you put the backup on. Mm-hmm. And then the malware can't do anything, and it's just you disinfect it and you didn't pay.
Yeah, I think the key is, as like you said, is making sure none of these devices are connected all the time.
Yes.
If you've got a backup, it's just for doing the backup, it's not...
Because, for instance, if you have your backup on Dropbox, just to make an example of a cloud, but you're still connected on Dropbox all the time, then what would happen is that in the moment it infects you, it's able to get to your Dropbox and infect your Dropbox part. And it's not the Dropbox responsibility, but it's just what happens. And Dropbox would see it just as something that is changing on your space, but it's not something they are managing, but they think you are managing it, while it's the ransomware that is infecting your computer and is managing your Dropbox at the same time.
I'd be interested, though, to see, because Dropbox keeps deleted files, and if you change a file's name, I wonder if it... Yeah, I don't know. I'd be a bit interested to try that, because...
It's possible, maybe, I never tried, it's possible... Maybe that Dropbox keeps a kind of record of what you have changed and is able to restore maybe to the most recent situation, but I'm not sure about that. Yeah. I never tried to do something like that.
So sometimes your floppies would die, so you often would make backup copies. Let's try this one. Sounds more hopeful. And so there was this game called Lander, which became the full game Zarch, and when this game was released, it was sort of full 3D graphics, which